Wait. You have a TV?
No. I just like to read the TV guide. Read the TV guide. You don't need a TV.
Hello, everybody. Welcome to TV Guidance Counselor. As always, I am Ken Reed. I am your TV Guidance Counselor entering my 39th year on this planet. Maybe I'll make it to 40. I don't know. Discussing classic television as I have done each and every week for the last 6 years. My guest this week is author Mathew Klickstein. You probably best know him as the author of Slimed, which was an oral history of the classic days of Nickelodeon, which is near and dear to my heart. I met him a few years ago when I was down in New York when that book came out. He did an event at 92Y that was sort of a reunion. I can't speak today. A reunion of, that's Larry in the background yelling at me. He is my dialect coach. For some classic cast members of shows like Hey Dude and Pete and Pete and You Can't Do That on Television and Double Dare and all kinds of things of that nature. He also was the co-author of Springfield Confidential with Mike Reese of The Simpsons fame, who was also a former guest of this show. You should check out that episode if you haven't yet. He's a busy guy. He's done a ton of stuff. And upcoming next month in August, he has a novel coming out called Selling Nostalgia, a neurotic novel. And then in September, he has a comic book series starting, which is called You Are Obsolete. And that's an ongoing series, so it'll probably be at least 100 issues, as most ongoing series do. But the guy is just doing everything. And if you want to keep tabs on him, he's not on social media, but he does have MatthewKlickstein.com. I suppose a website counts as social media. It's media. It's kind of social. It's twisted and sad, but social. Anyway, he lives in Colorado now, so when I was out for Denver Pop Culture Con, appropriately, I sat down and talked to him. If you have any questions for me, incidentally, you can do so. You can ask those questions. That's doing so at tvguidancecounselor@gmail.com or ken@iCanRead.com. We're also on all the social media that Matthew is not. We are on Facebook, Ken Reed Comedy, TV Guidance Counselor, on Instagram and Twitter at TV Guidance or at Kenneth W. Reed, R-E-I-D. So you can find us there. Patreon as well. Just search TV Guidance Counselor /TV Guidance Counselor. And thank you to everyone who contributes to that Patreon. Anyway, please sit back, relax, and enjoy this week's episode of TV Guidance Counselor with my guest, Mathew Klickstein.
TV is my friend, and it has been always there for me in time of need.
Mathew Klickstein, how are you?
Good, doing very well. Very, very satiated from a big meal. Thank
yes,
you, Ken.
Mathew and his wife made the mistake of allowing me to order for the table at a restaurant, and frequent listeners of the show will know that that's never a good idea.
You ordered, I think, the entire happy hour menu, but we did have a waitress come over to us and praise us
yes,
for what we did.
She actually
thought we were very brave.
She actually legitimately said, I'm so, what did she say, proud?
She didn't say that's really cool. It was something like she was awestruck.
Yeah, it had
by
like
our
a
courage, I feel.
It had esteem to it.
She certainly said something along the lines of proud.
Yeah. Yeah, we had like a little bistro table, and he's not kidding. I did order the whole menu. But that's what I do. It was a long travel day. That was the only meal I had. So you are living here in Colorado now,
but
you grew up in Southern California.
I did. I grew up in Southern California. I went to film school at USC.
And where in Southern California did you grow up?
Southern Orange County area.
Okay.
So, and my dad was more San Diego. My parents were divorced, so I kind of scuttled back and forth a lot. My mom moved around a little bit as well throughout the area. But, yeah. And it was right before all the TV shows and movies about Orange County that all of my friends and I were kind of baffled about.
Right. For example, Orange County.
Right. Yeah. I mean, they really should have called all those TV shows and movies Newport Beach. It really would have been like calling a TV show or movie L.A. and having it all take place in Malibu. Because
right.
That was not the experience many friends of mine and I growing up had.
Because that was like the O.C. and that sort of stuff.
Yeah. In fact, I still will never forget. I was at USC when a friend of mine's dad was visiting from out of town. And I was telling him where I was from. And he actually said, oh, you're from Orange County. And I remember specifically thinking, how do you know what county I live in?
Yeah.
Because I didn't didn't even realize it was a thing. And then suddenly all the shows and movies, yeah. It was like, uh-oh. So a lot of times I'll actually tell people, I'm from San Diego area.
Yeah.
It's just embarrassing to say I'm from Orange County.
Because it'd be like if someone said to me, like, oh, you're from Middlesex County?
Yeah.
I'm like, yeah, that's not a thing. See, because I always just associate Orange County with 80s LA punk rock.
Like, yeah, the, no, like that was definitely scene, around. Or the skating scene. I mean, my childhood growing up was a lot like, I Jonah Hill got it kind of close with mid-90s, but I mean, anywhere you went, there were people setting up lights and doing tricks and such on their skateboards, and their friends would be videotaping with those huge camcorders.
It's like the Bones Brigade guys.
It was just constantly around. I mean, you got used to, it's like being in LA where they're shooting a movie. Everyone was always shooting stuff, and even our high school was in one of the birdhouse, I think.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Videos where they crashed into the school. That was one of our, that was at our high school. So that scene was really around, and definitely the pop punk scene. I mean, I remember how excited we all were when Damn It was on Can't Hardly Wait. You know, we had friends that knew the guys from Blink and all that. And, you know, it was sort of cool. And then I went to college and I had a friend who gave me a Blink a tape. One side was Fugazi and one side was Pavement. I literally went home that Christmas break and basically threw away all of my CDs. I said, oh, this is real punk. No more Blink-182 for me.
Yeah.
Fugazi from now on.
Yeah. It's funny because I think I'm a little bit older than you, I think. And it's not really ironic. It's appropriate. But I instantly think of the Skate TV show, which was one of Nickelodeon's earliest not imported from Canada shows.
Sure.
And that's what it was. It was exactly those people filming those videos, except Matthew Lillard was hosting it.
Right. Well, yeah. And they also, they had a really early roller coaster show with a very young Matt Dillon
as
well. Yeah. So, I've been doing a lot of research on, of course, the modern comedy scene and whatnot. And I never really thought about it before. It makes sense. But the reason so many of those comedy specials started coming up on HBO and the like is that material is just so cheap.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and it's black box. The talent's not very expensive. It's pretty simple. You already have the audience there. So those kinds of shows like Skate TV and I think it was called Wild Rides was the roller coaster one with Matt Dillon. You know, it was so cheap to do. It was probably less expensive than licensing some of the other material that they were getting. And of course, Pinwheel was really just a lot of Eastern European animation. Right, because for the same reason.
Except for Teenie Little Super Guy, which is my favorite. Can't judge a hero by his size.
I think was Coco Canadian. The Clown was my jam. I love her.
But, you know, it's you bring up an interesting point where at that time in the 80s, it was sort of akin to the first 10 years of television where they killed vaudeville by putting all these people's act, you know, 40 years of acts on TV. Cause they were like, we have these built in acts. They're cheap. We're easy to film. What they didn't get was those people only did one act. They worked on it for 10 years and then they did that same act for another 30 years. And now that it's on TV, their act is done. And you kind of got that with stand up as well. But the biggest things on TV were always the cheapest to film. And that's why wrestling was on TV very early and why professional bowling was the biggest sport in America for almost until the 80s. Cause it's so easy to just throw a camera in a bowling alley.
Sure.
Much easier than in a football stadium. So, we did get all those comedy specials and there were so many comedians. So it was just real cheap and easy to throw a camera in a club that was already doing a show.
Right.
I enjoyed Skate TV. But I always had this weird affinity for like Southern California punk rock surf culture, even though I grew up like angry in the Northeast. So, beats me.
Yeah. No, the pop punk of Orange County was pretty saccharine and goofy and happy. And there's no surprise that a lot of those guys align with like the Jackass guys and that kind of stuff.
Yeah.
That was another that when all that started happening, when everyone's laughing at each other's jokes so uproariously and so forth, I started kind of getting tired of it. So my friend, and we actually just talked about this earlier, my friend, it was Andrew Raposa, whose dad, Joe Raposa, did the music for Three's Company and a lot of stuff on the Muppets and some other shows and whatnot. He gave me a tape and one side was Fugazi and one side was Pavement. And he was also pushing a lot of other things on me. And it was just great. I would kind of go over to his dorm room and he would just play me all this amazing material and some really good hip hop. And he was, in all fairness, a rich New York kid who liked to be punk and skate and all this stuff. So it was sort of the best of both worlds. But he really inspired me into realizing that a lot of the quote-unquote punk music that I thought I was listening to as a kid was kind of garbage.
But that's that kind of big joke. Are you an only child? Or so, but that's that kind of Big Brother thing that, you know, it is lost on kids now because they can access anything whenever they want. But there was something magical about somebody, number one, recommending something to you, but also they granted you access to things.
Sure.
So by him making a tape for you, those bands were probably something you couldn't have easily found otherwise.
Yeah, and certainly not something like Fugazi. I mean,
yeah.
Some of the material he gave me, and I became very close to a lot of grad students in film school too, just for a similar reason. It was great to learn so much about film and music and such from them. That was really my education while I was at USC, was just meshing with all these other kids from around the country and the world, especially a lot of the older ones. And, but some of them would push things like Sonic Youth and again, Pixies and such. And it was great. But Andrew, you know, just, it's pretty specific to get Fugazi or Bikini Kill. And he really taught me a lot about Riot Grrl and Kathleen Hanna. And it was mind blowing. And it really was like, I had no idea that existed.
It's a whole hidden world you're unaware of.
And it was more of what I really wanted. I know, I'm sure you're probably familiar with the story too, but it was like when John Belushi first heard punk himself.
Oh, yeah.
Kind of was like, I'm done with blues. This is the stuff. And had to get like Fear on Saturday Night Live. And I mean, it really felt like that. It was extremely life changing for me. And I almost can see my life bifurcated between, you know, before Andrew and after. In all fairness, though, senior year, we had an English foreign exchange student from England, actually. And he got a lot of us into Rancid and early Radiohead right before they broke. So we were all listening to Radiohead before anyone else.
Because he only listened to bands that started with R.
Yeah, exactly. But I mean, we were, you know, it was Pablo Honey days and whatnot. And so he also taught us about, of course, a lot of the shows on BBC, Dark Star and the original Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. And so he was an interesting guy. Unfortunately, I didn't know him a few years later when Space came on.
Right.
So I didn't get to Space till much, much later when it was all on DVD and so forth. I wish he was around for that because I would have liked to have watched Space when I was a lot younger. I think it would have helped me a lot.
Yeah. I mean, Space did air here. Comedy Central aired it very briefly late at night, and Bravo aired it, of all things, for
that
a short
sense,
time.
Because they also had that Rick Mayall show where he like read a book or something.
The fairy tale one. And they showed Bottom and stuff as well. And Bravo showed Twitch City, the Don McKellar Canadian. Oh, you got to see Twitch City. It's one of the best comedies I've ever seen. But they did. You could catch that stuff every now and then, but you had to just blindly stumble on it.
I remember for a while they were showing a ton of Absolutely Fabulous.
Oh yeah, Comedy Central used it as filler.
Oh, God,
yeah,
that show is fantastic.
Yeah,
both those gals are just amazing.
Well, I mean, the Young Ones is how I stumbled on the Young Ones on MTV.
Yeah.
They used to air the Young Ones and the Monkees back to back.
Oh wow, that's awesome.
It's a great, it really is. And I was 5 or 6 years old, and
sure.
So you know what I'm sort of building here is, for those of us who grew up pre-millennium, it's a combination of stumbling on things, happenstance, right place, right time, and then these people who sort of initiate you into a world that you were previously unaware of. And I think for that reason, you know, and I don't think it's, I'm not saying things were better then or now or whatever, but for that reason, these things tend to stick with us more because they, like you said, your life can be split into before and after in a lot of ways instead of, and you're invested in it. Like somebody took the time and had and advocated for something to you, you probably sat and listened to the whole tape, and you might not have even liked it. You might have just been like, I gotta get this.
I loved it right away.
You know what I mean? Like, but now, like, kids would be like, skip, you know, because you don't have to.
Well, that's Tarantino, as I'm sure you know, has talked a lot about why he doesn't like Netflix for that very reason. Is it makes him very upset that when you go to a movie at a movie theater, you're making the plan to go, you're finding parking, you're paying the $15, you're sitting through the trailers, you're waiting online. It is an investment. So if the movie's not knocking you off your socks right away, you might stick through it. And a lot of the time you realize, oh, I'm glad I stuck through it. That movie actually turned out to be pretty good. Whereas on Netflix, like, this isn't so great. And they just flip right through.
Yeah,
which is really a shame.
But that's true of everything. I think, like, you know, I talk about this a lot too. Like, there are albums I bought that I hated,
but I'm like, I spent 15 right. bucks on this. I'm going to sit here and listen to it. And then those end up becoming my favorite sure. albums. Or you'd rent a movie and you're like, I paid $3. I'm not going back to the store. I'm going to watch it. And then you love it. You know, yeah. so it's even that small of an investment. You were like, I guess I have to watch it. So when you don't, when there's nothing on the line, even a really nominal couple of bucks, you just, you don't take a risk or you don't challenge yourself to enjoy something that, if it doesn't click with you right away.
And it's unfortunate too. I would imagine a lot of your listeners are aware of this now since we're all so meta these days anyway, and that's a lot of what the show is. But it's affecting the production of a lot of products yeah. now too, because people are starting to realize, oh, we have to make the first 10 minutes like bam, zoom, wham, or people will flip. And I've never actually had to experience this myself, fortunately, and I've worked with a lot of different publishers for my books. But a friend of mine recently said the publisher he was working with was really forcing him to make sure those first 15 pages were bam, zoom, whiz, because that's the sample that a lot of like Amazon and whatnot gives you
right.
before you buy the book. And his book was a pretty didactic, turgid, educational, you know, exegesis on
yeah.
using words like all that nonsense.
Well, ruins your pacing.
Yeah. Right. But his book just wasn't that. It was about yeah. computers and the way technology has changed. And it's kind of like, and he had been working on it for a few years and he was a smart guy. He used to write for all these big magazines. And he was just telling me, he's like, I can't get those first 15 pages to be what they want. And he had been working on he traveled to India and Silicon Valley, and they were just berating him about those first 15 pages. He was like, Matt, what am I supposed to do? Have like, you know, some like a drug killing in it or something yeah. like that? Like that's not this kind of book, but that's what they wanted.
How can you fit tits into this?
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah. Could you do like every scumbag voice I do is Boston. I'm sorry. You know, I got the computers and everything. Maybe like a 50 Shades of Grey, just for 14 pages.
Right.
Then you talk, you know, like I was thinking silicon boobies, you know, yeah, like it fits. So you come back.
We got to have the cigar that you're chomping to yeah. right there, Bernie.
Yeah. yeah. But it's true. You know, I think people who aren't creative, who are the people that make financial decisions and greenlight stuff, come up with what they think is a successful formula. It's never that, because you almost can't recreate things in that way artistically. And things also hit based on a time and a place. And it's a series of things that all line up. And they try to put everything in that formula and it just doesn't work. But at the same time, some of the best art that I love is a result of directly defying rules or having to work within a confine and it making someone think in a way they normally wouldn't. So, you know, it's hard to pick and choose, but it's annoying.
No, and I mean, I think a really good example that I can think of for having the chaos happening, but in a contained box, the two that come to mind right away are John Chris Felucci for Ren and Stimpy. When he had to tone down a lot of what he wanted to do for Nickelodeon and a lot of some of the anger and vitriol and disgusting stuff that he was doing with Ren and Stimpy also was tempered by Vanessa Coffey and Linda Siminski and Mary Harrington, who were running the Nicktoons block at the time. They were the ones really bringing in and saying, you know, let's make Ren and Stimpy love each other. Let's make them friends. Let's give them, you know, let's make them those kinds of characters so that John's wild genius would work within that. And so it works so well in Nickelodeon, but we see what happened when he brings it over to, what was it, Spike TV.
And he just can do whatever he wants.
It's
garbage.
And it lasts, what, six episodes?
It's too much.
Yeah, and the example I always like to use for this kind of thing is David Lynch. I love David Lynch, you know, frontwards, backwards, and every way in between. I even love Inland Empire. I love his weird show that no one's seen, but you probably have heard of, On the Air.
Oh, yeah.
And
his comedy.
Everything and anything he's ever done, I love David Lynch. But as much as I love Inland Empire, it saddens me that probably was a bit of a hitch in his career because he just went so off the deep end.
Right.
And you know, why would anyone else, you know, in the money world want to give him money anymore?
Whereas
and,
if you look at something like The Straight Story.
Right, exactly.
Which he's making a G-rated movie for Disney.
Right.
But it's, I think, probably his best movie.
Yeah.
It's very him. It's absolutely a David Lynch movie
absolutely.
In every way possible. But it's also a sweet G-rated Disney movie.
Himself.
Yeah.
And you know, you see the same thing with Terry Gilliam, too. One of the best reviews I read of just, I'm sorry, the absolutely deplorable, boring, interminable, torturous Don Quixote movie that we were all waiting for like 30
right,
years,
right,
which
right.
was just the worst thing I've ever seen. But the person, I forget even who did the review, was making the point that some of Gilliam's best movies are someone else wrote the screenplay.
Yeah.
And he's an amazing... And look, there's no question that Don Quixote had all the spectacular images and some great vision. And, you know, if that movie were on mute and you played some really great music, I probably would have enjoyed it. But the script and the story and the characters were just horrible. And so, yeah, a lot of his best movies are when someone else wrote the screenplay.
Well, that's what I always say about M. Night Shyamalan. I'm like, if M. Night Shyamalan, the producer, would stop hiring M. Night Shyamalan, the writer, and just have the director direct other people's scripts, and no one hired M. Night Shyamalan, the actor, he would make much better movies. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. It's like, get out of your own way, man. Like, yeah. Don't...
No, The Devil is probably his best movie, and that was the one he had, like, the least to do with.
Yeah, it's like, you know, being a great director does not mean you're a good writer, necessarily. Yeah, that's a really rare thing.
Sure.
We can't all be Bo Jackson. That's the only sports reference people are getting from me that's 40 years old. So let's dive in here. You immediately went to this one because it has a beautiful AmCell pencil drawing of the cast of Three's Company, the classic cast. We still have Chrissy on here. This is May 20th to the 26th, 1978. So this predates both of our births.
Indeed.
But would you go with Saturday Night?
For Saturday Night, I went a little early, and for 7:30... I'm going to switch around between two of the classics, Mary Tyler Moore and Dick Van Dyke.
Yep.
And then just for shits and giggles, I'm popping over to the Gong Show because it can't get me enough of my Chuck Barris. And hopefully that night we'll have a little bit of
Unknown name. Comic?
Unknown Comic.
Or Gene the Dancing Machine?
No, that I was going to say Unknown Comic. Yeah, so, but no, I would have loved
Murray Langston.
Murray Langston, that's right, who created his own comedy club, actually. Yep.
And he wrote and directed a movie called Night Force.
Wow, that I did not
with,
know.
It's like a Police Academy ripoff, and it stars Linda Blair.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
How old was she then?
She's like 20.
Oh my goodness. Good gravy. So I would have been bouncing around between those three. Probably would have spent most of my time on Mary Tyler Moore. But during the commercials, I think I'd switch between Dick Van Dyke and Gong Show.
Also Gong Show, one of the celebrity judges, Rex Reed.
Oh, well, there
you go. It's going to be great.
Yeah.
It's going to be great.
Heck yeah.
Then what'd you do after that?
8 p.m. as we discussed, I'd be watching Theater of Blood.
Yes, which you just recently found.
And I cannot remember where I read about it. And it the description sounded so compelling to me and exactly the kind of movie that I love watching, especially with Vincent Price in it and the year that it was.
Yep, 73.
It sounded like a great Hammer meets Russ Meyer film.
Yep.
And so I had to give it a go. I watched it for free. Someone uploaded it for free on YouTube. Sorry. But I thought it was just fantastic. The scene with the dogs.
Yes.
That was what really did it for me when I read that.
Yep.
And to see it in the film, they did it fantastically. Oh, that was great.
Diana Rigg is in it, and there are scenes where she's dressed as a man, very convincingly, weirdly.
Oh, spoiler alert.
Yeah, well, everyone who's listening to this show has seen Theater of Blood.
Okay, well, that's good.
Theater of Blood was the weakest. It was a ripoff of Dr. Fives movies, which were big hits the previous year, 2 years. So they just reused the formula, but it works great. And the stuff that I love in it is the faked footage of Vincent Price as the actor he plays in the movie doing these Shakespearean roles. So it's like him as Othello and him doing, you know, these things that Vincent Price never got to do on camera by the 70s because he was sort of the king of camp.
Yeah.
But it's a fun movie. And if you have a multi-region Blu-ray player, I highly recommend the Region 2 UK disc, which features a commentary by the League of Gentlemen.
Oh,
and
that makes sense.
They are huge horror nerds, and that is one of their favorite movies.
That particular
movies.
Film would probably really ring their bell.
That commentary is amazing. They do a few. They also do a commentary on a Teagan movie called Blood on Satan's Claw, and it's a very interesting movie. But their commentary is the greatest thing I've ever heard. It's just so fun. It's like having
Theater
friends.
Of Blood was a good time. And if you need any further recommendation, as I told Ken earlier. I actually, it just struck me as something that Mike Reese of The Simpsons and The Critic would have liked a lot. Particularly, I think, because of The Critic.
The Critic,
and,
very much, yeah.
So I actually emailed him right after. I said, by the way, have you ever seen a film called Theater of Blood? If you haven't, I think you'd like it. And he emailed me back right away and said, one of my favorite movies of all time.
Yeah, of course.
And Mike does not suffer fools. If he doesn't like something, he'll tell me or anyone else.
Yeah.
So.
And that movie actually, Price is a good actor.
Oh, he's great.
And he manages to bring to that movie, because everyone probably knows the plot, but it's about sort of a disgraced older Shakespearean actor who takes revenge on his critics for giving him bad reviews. And it does
via themes from each of these Shakespearean plays.
Yes.
That's part of what I really
and like. It was created by people who did the Avengers. So it has that vibe to it. That sort of surreal, weird 60s vibe. But it has this meta angle where Vincent Price is also sort of acting out how he really feels about what his career has been at that point. And it's an interesting watch. If you've ever seen Witchfinder General or The Conqueror Worm, that is a movie where it's a deadly serious horror movie from 2 years before that. And he plays a real guy who was a witchfinder in the Cromwell times who would basically go to towns and like burn and kill women.
Oh, wow.
And there's a famous story where the director was a young guy. He was in his 20s. He actually died after that. He overdosed. But he gets in an argument with Vincent Price because Price is playing it too campy. And he keeps being like, bring it down, bring it down. And Price snaps. And he's like, I've made over 100 films. How many have you made? And the guy goes, 2 good ones.
Oh,
and
nice.
Price was like, okay. And he has this really underplayed, terrifying, like very rough, scary role. And it's seeing those pieces of him and things is always great. Because Dr. Fibes, he does it too, but he's under so much makeup. He manages to give a pathos and an empathy to the character, but it comes through a little bit better in Theater of Blood, I think, because it's closer to the real him.
And how it walks the line between cringiness, comedy, the Shakespearean distinction, the horror.
It's very EC Comics, too.
Yeah, totally that. And it actually reminded me a lot of one of my favorite movies of all time, Wicker Man, the original, of course. And even his role seemed a lot like Christopher Lee's role, which, of course, those comparisons are always made anyway.
Oh, you got to see Witchfinder General.
There was a lot that reminded me of Wicker Man and the way that the genre is constantly changing. And there are times you're not sure if you're supposed to laugh. And there's horrifying things that are kind of funny. And then funny things are actually kind of scarier. And I love movies like Theater of Blood or Wicker Man that you're not really ever fully sure what you're supposed to think or feel. I'm finishing a comic book series, my first comic book series, actually, it's going to come out in September, and I keep bringing that up with the editors, and I keep basically making these comparisons to Wicker Man and to a lot of Cronenberg's work and to even Twin Peaks, because they'll sometimes say, well, the emotion here is a little confusing, and I'll say, I know, I want it to be kind of like this, and that's why you should draw it like that.
Yeah.
And as soon as I say Twin Peaks or Wicker Man, they go, okay, we got it. Because, like, yeah, I want it to have that kind of weird, scary, funny, cringy feel that all those
There's an ambiguity, have. And all of those feelings are all cousins of each other. And they all have similar mechanics, and they do work together, but it's hard to mix them.
Well, it's just in playing with the emotion. I mean, the comic book that I'm working on, for example, opens with kind of a horrifying birthday party. And I really want it to be clear that I wanted people to be wearing, like, the hat's a little bit askance, and the cake is really pink. Yeah. And I want, and like the
things
balloons
are slightly off.
Yeah, but it's sort of horrifying, but also like it's a playful, fun birthday party. And I just thought that those two things together, and the guy who did the drawing did such a fantastic, he completely nailed it. And you could just see it even without the lettering on it yet, that it's kind of funny, it's kind of scary, and that those two things together make it that much more intense.
I'm picturing like a Charles Burns kind of black hole.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So Sunday night, what'd you do?
Sunday night, I'm doing All in the Family, Alice, and then I'm wrapping it up. I need a little bit of faith in my life.
Yeah.
So I'm bringing in some Jerry Falwell, and he's got on just one of my favorite spokespeople for oranges of all time, Anita Bryant.
Yes.
And I think that bookending Alice with All in the Family and Jerry Falwell having Anita Bryant on, I mean, that's a full menu right there. That's my appetizer, my entree, and my dessert.
Yeah. I mean, this is a repeat of All in the Family, but it's a good one. Also, there was in the 80s, there was a campaign for orange juice. And I don't know who sang the song, but it went, orange juice, there's nothing like it. in the world. It was the worst. And it was like one of those just generic oranges, you know, ads.
I hope for some reason it's flashing my head, Rosie Greer, just from
From the thing with two heads. Yeah. Or like Hoyt Axton used to always do peaches.
Oh, really?
He'd be like, buy Georgia peaches. Like, I can't do a good Hoyt Axton. I'll work on it. But yeah, I mean, you also said you had never seen Alice.
I never seen Alice. I've watched the film.
Alice doesn't live here anymore.
Yeah, that it was based on multiple times. I've written about it.
It's very different.
Yeah, so I understand. Although it wasn't the original kid from Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, I think was in the pilot of Alice and then was not used in the actual film.
Yeah.
Yeah, or the actual show. But no, I never actually watched Alice, but I'd be interested to see her semi-further adventures. But I love the film. Of course, the ending's extremely disappointing. And I know that Scorsese and team didn't really want to do it like that. It kind of has that Hollywood ending of, you know, everyone applauding at the end at the restaurant.
Right.
But aside from that, I think that movie's great. And also, I'd heard of Mott the Hoople before, but that's where I really got into Mott the Hoople because of all the Mott the Hoople in that film. So did it for me. And Ellen Burstyn is just fantastic. And frankly, for my money, anything that Kris Kristofferson's going to be in, I'm going to give it a thumbs up. And probably one of my favorite Harvey Keitel roles also. I thought he was really sensational.
Very early Keitel role.
Yeah. And he's perfect because it's like he's so little and he's so angry and it just works out really, really well. And also, I had a very similar relationship with my mom that it's Danny. Is it his? Danny and that Alice have. That was very much what my life was like growing up.
Is it Tommy?
It might be Tommy. Whomever it is, that was very much my relationship. Whenever I see movies where there's a really powerful single mother and young son relationship, 20th Century Women, for example, and Mike Mills is another, he is an Orange County guy. I love all of his films, even his early stuff that he did. And he's got some great interviews in that beautiful Losers documentary that's also fantastic. But 20th Century Women, it was such really, really close to my childhood. And there were scenes that I even turned to. I think I was married at the time. Or I was maybe at least dating my wife, but I turned to her and I was like, that's my mom. The moment when she's at the principal's office. And I mean, that was my relationship. And I did have a fair amount of older women in my life because they were all my babysitters because my mom was out a lot dating or whatever. I had very much the upbringing of 20th Century Women. And in fact, if he had made that maybe 10 years later, I'm glad he didn't because I love also the time period he chose, it would have been my life.
But it's interesting where that stuff doesn't hit you immediately sometimes, or like it's hard for you to put your life and experiences in a context that you could convey because you're too close to it, and then you see someone who has done it and you go, yeah. And it you would never have approached it thinking it would be that, but then it just hits you and it's crazy.
Yeah.
This is a Christmas episode, by the way, in the middle of May. Have you ever heard the David Bowie, Mott the Hoople, Top of the Pops story?
No, but you know what's funny is when I started listening to Mott the Hoople, I hit up a friend of mine who was so obsessed with David Bowie. I think to this day his email is still blank@davidbowie.com. And I was like, did Bowie just completely rip these guys off?
Oh, yeah.
It sounds like Bowie Bowie was Bowie.
They have very strict union rules in the UK, especially for studio musicians. And when they were recording that song, there's a piano chord in it that they just couldn't, no one could play it. And it's a weird chord. So Bowie plays it on the recording because he wrote the song and he's like, yeah, it's just this. So when Mott the Hoople performed it on Top of the Pops, Bowie had to go play the piano because you had to have the musicians who played it in the studio play it on the show, even if they were miming.
Wow.
So it's on YouTube, but it's hilarious footage of just like random David Bowie in the background playing one piano chord because the rules.
Wow.
And it's just such a weird thing.
Wait, Weird and David Bowie together.
Who would have thought?
Yeah.
Made all his own suits. Monday night, what'd you go with?
I don't know what the hell this is. It's 7:30. I had to put this in even though it's a little early. But it literally says documentary. People in small towns
Yep.
Amuse themselves by dramatizing everything.
Yep.
That sounds amazing.
This is
we need to find this.
Yep. This
what
is
the
a,
hell is, it doesn't even have a title.
This is a PBS documentary. Some of, in the 70s, PBS did some incredible documentaries.
That sounds incredible.
And they really just did like fly on the wall stuff. Like we before we were recording, we were talking about Albert Brooks's Real Life. Mm-hmm. And that was based on American Family, which was sure. PBS's documentary. It was one of the first reality shows, The Loud Family. And they really, in the 70s, PBS, they were just pumping out these fascinating documentaries. And this one, yeah, people in small towns amuse themselves by dramatizing everything, notes Endora Wheaty. In the second of three programs with Pulitzer Prize winning author, she illustrates the point by reading her short story, Why I Live at the P.O., in a comic tale about a petty family feud. So it was just these like weird, you know, PBS was also kind of doing the thing like we'll throw anything up, like plays and things, but they also were curating it a little more. And it was... it's kind of fascinating to see a lot of that stuff. And luckily, PBS was very good about archiving their stuff. So you can access a lot of their stuff, documentaries and things.
For 8 o'clock, of course, I'm going with Mr. Gene Shepard. There's a show. Was this a regular show or just a special? Shepherd's Pie.
Yeah, it was a special. So, and he actually was on Evening Magazine before that promoting this. But yeah, this was much like it sounds like that documentary. It was like raconteurs. Like
and if anyone's a fan of Christmas Story and has not yet actually read any of Gene Shepherd's stories upon which much of Christmas Story is based, yep. I highly recommend it.
In God We Trust, all others pay cash.
What's great too is I'm sure, yeah, and he it's still a lot of the stable, the same characters. One of the books, I forget which one, he actually goes to, I think it's one of his friends is now owns the bar that I guess his dad owned.
Yeah.
So he's talking with him and that's how the stories kind of come up. So it's just really, and the stuff of him in Vietnam. So it's got still that same Gene Shepherd voice, but on all these other experiences that he had when he first got into Hollywood and so forth. My very good friend Cassine Gaines wrote the Christmas Story book, and he just had all these amazing, amazing tales of people talking about Gene Shepherd and whatnot. So if you have a chance, read Cassine Gaines' book on that.
And actually, and a lot of Gene Shepherd's books are, there's audio versions with him reading almost all of them.
Because he was a radio person.
Yeah.
First
of all. Although sometimes, be a little careful, some of them are literally just him playing the trumpet for like an hour. But this one is a humorous Gene Shepherd explores the world of the fast food burger joint.
That sounds great.
Which sounds amazing. Yeah, I've never heard that.
It's Gene Shepherd does Guy Fieri over here. And then at 8:30, I'm doing Dick Cavett having on Arthur Godfrey.
Yep. I think that which is pretty great.
Yeah. And then 9 o'clock, I'm bouncing back and forth. This one was a tough one. We have Louise Lasser, a favorite of mine, writes and directs a made-for-TV movie called Just Me and You, where it's a harried New York woman is driving to L.A. with a even-keeled salesman played by Charles Grodin.
Charles Grodin character.
Yeah, exactly. Which really just sounds exactly like the beginning of When Harry Met Sally with Louise Lasser and Charles Grodin. And it's funny, too, because also, have you ever seen the original Heartbreak Kid?
Yes.
That's how the Heartbreak Kid opens, the original. Like, it is that car ride, and Grodin is basically that character.
That's his thing,
well,
man.
So.
But also, like... In 1978, they're letting Louise Lasser... I mean, Alice was a huge show. Mm-hmm. But Louise Lasser is writing and starring in a TV movie.
Mm-hmm.
That's a big deal. Like, that's unusual. That would be unusual now if we had a famous TV actress writing and starring in her own made-for-TV movie. Like, that would be still unusual. And we're talking, you know, over 40 years ago.
Yeah, though right now we have what? We have Amy Poehler has her film out right now.
Yeah.
White Country... And then I hear that Olivia Wilde's film, Booksmart, is supposed to be awesome. And then I'm interested in, I always mix up her with Alison Brie. Brie Larson.
Oh, yes, yeah.
Movie Unicorn Star.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Looks kind of interesting. That looks a little less my taste, but I definitely want to see Booksmart. And I'm curious about the Amy Poehler film. I've not heard good things about it, in all fairness, but I want to see it.
But it's probably not for you.
What? Yeah, that's
yeah.
But I mean, I love Amy Poehler. She just finally read her book, which was a lot of fun.
She's a Boston
person. And I, you know, look, I know people make fun of the early UCB. She does even
do
a little
bit
in her book. Yeah, she even kind of makes fun of it a little bit in her book. But I was an early fan, right?
Oh yeah,
away, and I knew that she was really special. I liked the Mats also,
yeah,
for obvious reason. But I knew that Amy was going to break out. And in fact, I've tried finding this on YouTube multiple times. I've tried finding it elsewhere. There was an incredible Daily Show when it was still Craig Kilborn, where he had on the UCBers.
Yes.
When they were all like kind of performing in a certain kind of, in their roles or whatnot. And then during the five questions, he actually asked, which one of you is going to break out and leave all the other ones behind? And I'll never forget Amy Poehler was laughing a little too hard.
Yeah, yeah.
But I love that, yeah.
You also passed up a world premiere two-part TV movie.
Uh-oh.
The Bastard.
Oh, yeah, no.
Born out of wedlock, despised by his brother, and hunted by assassins. Philip Kent arrived in a dangerous new land, ready to fight for freedom. Starring Andrew Stevens, Patricia Neal, Harry Morgan, Tom Bosley. Olivia Hussey, Buddy Ebsen, William Shatner, Keenan Wynn, Lauren Green, Cameron Mitchell, Donald Pleasance, and Eleanor Parker.
That sounds like something that Homer Simpson would be really into by the cast alone.
Or would go on to MST3K.
I had a friend in high school, and I don't know why, but our English teacher stupidly had a copy of the book, The Bastard.
Yeah.
And I would consistently put it on his desk before he would get to class. Because that's just the kind of 16-year-old I was in an honors English class.
I mean, bastard's one of my favorite curses.
I learned that word from Back to the Future. I remember hearing it, not knowing what it meant, and that's where I learned the word bastard.
Yeah, it's a fun one. It's fun to say. People know that you're, like, cursing them out, but also isn't, like, super offensive, right. So you can get away with it.
Sure.
It makes you sound a little bit smart. It's sort of, it's a little bit classy.
Right.
Bastard.
Yeah, there is a classiness to it. Yeah, for sure.
English nobleman. Tom
but I will say real quick, because I know we talked about this a little bit. During the commercials from the Louise Lasser made-for-TV movie, I would flip over to Meeting the Minds solely because there is apparently a portrayal of Emily Dickinson by the late, great Catherine Hellman.
Which I can't even imagine what that's like. I'm going to try to dig that up now, actually.
Yeah, that sounds great.
Which was in poor taste to say that because she died recently, but I'm not going to dig up Catherine Hellman. I'm going to dig up that performance.
And
but,
we were just talking about Terry Gilliam, too. So
yeah, that's true.
Back together again.
But she, you know, she really didn't get enough praise for the work that she did. Like she's obviously the best part of Who's the Boss.
Sure.
She was great on Soap, but like, you know, in Brazil, and but she did so much stuff that just you know,
you're right
for discovery.
She's someone that deserves much more accolades than she ever got, and it's a shame, especially, I mean, just that role in Brazil is wow.
It's funny and dark and complicated, and she's a great actor. Yeah.
She's good.
How about Wednesday night?
Are we skipping over Tuesday?
Oh, did we skip Tuesday? Sorry. I don't know. It's a mile up and my brain doesn't work.
Oh, there we go.
Tuesday, what are we doing?
Tuesday. I have a lot for Tuesday, so I'm going to zoom through Tuesday starting at 7 p.m. with Zoom.
Yes, produced by WGBH.
I loved watching Zoom as a kid. What a weird show. There it is again. It's like, it was kind of dark and strange, but yet it was a kid's show.
And speaking of Amy Poehler, she wrote in, because Zoom would do a thing where you could write in stories and they would act them out. She wrote in stories to that a bunch. Like, wow. She's a huge Zoom fan because it was produced in Boston.
Yeah, sure.
And so, and she's told stories before about writing into Zoom all the time, which is kind of amazing.
And, you know, just for a little bit of the other side of the fence, I don't know, would they be doing commercials on PBS?
No.
Okay, well, still, I would switch over to watch some Harold Lloyd's feet first.
Yeah, there you go.
I can't get enough of my Harold Lloyd. At 7:30, I'm going to continue the classics and watch some Abbott Costello, mixing it up with some Gong Show and Muppet Show.
With Don Knotts as the
yeah,
host.
Well, hey, that's why I got to do it. At 8 o'clock, I'm doing Happy Days, reluctantly. Never a big Happy Days fan.
Here's a weird thing at 7:30. The Muppet Show's on two different channels at the same time, two different episodes.
Whoa.
So Channel 5 is showing the Don Knotts Muppet Show. Channel 9 is showing the Judy Collins Muppet Show.
You know, the Judy Collins one is the one I wrote down. I must have missed the Don Knotts one. But that is one that I would watch. And where the hell is the Don Knotts movie? I need a Don Knotts movie, and I need it now. We better do it before Steve Buscemi gets too old.
Have you ever seen The Love God?
What?
The Love God?
It was that one of his, like, kind of reluctant astronaut type movies?
No, it was written and directed by Nat Heinken, who created Car 54, Where Are You? And The Phil Silver Show.
Mm-hmm.
And he actually died before it came out. But it is one of my favorite comedies, if not my favorite comedy. It's ridiculously modern. You could take the script as is now, produce it now, would not seem dated in the least. It's really funny and smart, and I don't know why everybody doesn't love that movie. Like, it's not a silly Don Knotts movie, which are fun,
yeah,
but it's just a great, great comedy. If you're going to watch one movie,
I will definitely see it. I can't get enough of Don Knotts. I bought the Don Knotts box set not once but twice. And I hate to say it, but the reason I did that was I lived with one gal in Long Beach, and so I bought it for her. And then we broke up and I left.
Because of that?
What? Because of the Don Knotts. Yeah. She was weirdly obsessed with Don Knotts, actually, which is one of the reasons I liked hanging out with her. But so she got to keep the box set. And then I actually was moving in with a gal when I first got to Lawrence, Kansas, and actually had it mailed to her from Amazon before I even got there, because I just wanted to make sure there was a Don Knotts box set there. And when we broke up, she also got to keep it.
So that's your move, man. Yeah, you're the Don Knotts guy.
I'm the Don Knotts kid. You can just call me that.
You also passed up a thing called All-Star Anything Goes. I don't know what this is, but it says models compete against actors. Oh, that's it.
Period.
That's nothing else. Yeah, no other. Yeah.
I'm going to keep up the Gary Marshall for 8:30. I'm doing some Laverne and Shirley. I'm also going to switch over to Dick Cavett with Stan Getz. Big, big Stan Getz fan. Love his material. 9 o'clock, of course, I'm doing my Three's Company. Love that episode in particular. Know it well.
This one is Janet keeps Mrs. Roper's company in Mr. Roper's absence, leaving Jack and Chrissy cozily alone for the evening.
And I have to say, and Ken will confirm this in case anyone thinks for some reason I'd be joking about this. Not that it's funny in the least, but I specifically asked for a TV guide that kind of featured Three's Company.
Right.
That was such an important show for me growing up. I really don't know why it captured my imagination the way that it did. But one of my first memories growing up, I must have been maybe 4 or 5 because my parents got divorced around 5 or 6. And my parents were there. But just brown shag carpet, the TV, and Three's Company. And there was just something about that show that, to this day, it's still extremely comforting to me.
Well, it's very Southern California.
Funny. Yeah, that's
true. It's very, you know, Santa Monica.
Yeah, yeah. Although, a lot of people didn't understand this. Orange County really was far away enough from LA in more ways than one that when I went to USC, I did have a lot of friends from out of state or out of country saying, Matt, where's this? Where's that? And I had to keep saying, look, guys, I'm as new to this as you.
Yeah.
I came up to LA for Universal Studios and maybe like a special event or something. It's not like I came up to LA to hang out or had friends up there or anything. It really might as well have been, you know, across the country or in another
country. In Connecticut and they're asking about Manhattan.
Exactly. Yeah. Or like, you know, even probably less so the case because probably a lot of people were going to Manhattan from New Jersey, but New Jersey to Manhattan.
Right.
But it really was a different world. But yeah, for some reason, Three's Company really got me, and it's one of those shows I can watch any episode at any time, over and over again. I love the music, I love the look. Many of my living rooms tend to end up looking like the living room.
Beige age color scheme.
Just the autumnal colors, the browns, the yellows, the reds. I love the artwork on the wall. Everything about the show. I love Don Knotts. I
Rattan, love wicker furniture.
Oh my God. And just the entire cast is great. Even some of the lesser peripheral characters and whatnot. I mean, I just love, and you know, I know that there's been some unfortunate revelations about him, but every time Jeffrey Tambor was on the show, he was great, and I did like him a lot, even in the crappy Roper spinoff.
I should mention, it's not just Don Knotts. It's horny Don Knotts.
Oh my God.
Which is a very special flavor of Don Knotts.
I have tried over and over and over again over the years to try to look up like, and at some point I feel like someone's going to end up doing it, but I look up like Don Knotts or Mr. Furley's, you know, jumpsuits or something. I cannot find anything even remotely close at any vintage store I go to. I have for so long
in my life. A safari suit.
Well, yeah, maybe that's what I need to look up, a safari suit.
Have you ever heard the balls story?
No.
So this is true. This sounds like an urban legend, but this is verified. Jack Tripper is wearing little shorts in the episode.
Yes.
So you do know this.
Yes, but it
got away with it for like 30 years before anyone noticed because TVs were small.
Right.
You know, and people didn't see stuff over and over.
They were going to bring up something about Don Knotts.
Knotts' balls. Don Knotts was constantly putting his balls on things.
But I know the John Ritter one. And, you know, a lot of people give, just to wrap this up, a lot of people give, you know, Three's Company some shit too. And you know, obviously there are aspects of it that, you know, wouldn't fly now and so forth. But There again, it's like we were talking about with Ren and Stimpy. There was a true love amongst all those characters that was enduring throughout the entire series. And I even love at the series finale when the girls are talking about, did Jack ever make a pass at you? And yeah, he played around with them. There was some teasing, and they did to him, and he did to them. But you know,
it's kind of innocent.
Yeah,
it's,
it was like an older brother situation.
It's juvenile. Yeah,
right. And even beyond juvenile, even beyond that, there was something that was actually a little bit more sophisticated. Like they were able to actually do that, and they dated different people. And I love the episodes when they would have their different dates come over, and Jack would just kind of be sitting on the couch, like, hey, what you doing? Like,
yeah.
And it's like he didn't even care, you know? And just the love that was there. And of course, there's the episode with Michael Bell, who a lot of people don't know, was actually a voice on Rugrats. I got to interview him before he passed, but you know, he was the dance instructor that fooled Janet into thinking she was more talented than she was and was getting her to do all these terrible things like quit her job and started being rude to people and became kind of a diva. And really, it turned out he just wanted her for her body, so to speak. And Jack Tripper had to kind of come in and save the day. And, you know, that moment toward the end gets me every time when, you know, she says, oh, you're going to tell me I told you so. And he goes, no, I was just going to say, may I have this dance? And
yeah,
I mean, what a beautiful moment.
It's a sweet moment. Yeah.
What a beautiful moment. I mean, you can't deride the show too much when there's moments like that.
Two things. One, that show Twitch City that I talked about has an episode called I Look Like Joyce DeWitt. And I won't tell you why, what the context is, or you got to see it. And also, have you ever seen the movie Real Men?
No.
Oh, God. It's amazing. Wow. John Ritter and James Belushi.
Oh, wow.
It's an insane comedy, and it's really weird, and it will surprise you. And I won't tell you anything else about it because it will legitimately surprise you.
I cannot believe there's another one. There are so many John Ritter movies out there that like never get talked about.
Once a Hero.
Never, you know, even like Skin Deep was pretty hard to find until recently. There was even just one recently that popped up that I can't remember the name of it now. You know, and he's great in
Bratishucky, Sling Blade.
No, Sling Blade, of course. Sling Blade really proved positive. It was almost kind of sad. It's like, don't forget, guys, John Ritter's an actor,
too.
He
absolutely
can fucking act, gang. Let's not forget that. But no, They All Laughed, the Peter Bogdanovich film.
Yeah.
You know, he's so good in that movie. Or Noises Off. I mean, that's a great film. So it's like, but yeah, it just seems like there's an endless supply of John Ritter movies.
But he was one of those guys that, you know, you were a TV actor or a movie actor, and there were people who were movie stars and should have been, but they could never break through the ceiling of being a TV actor. And now that doesn't matter, but it really was a thing. Like, there were so few people that were able to break through.
I don't want to give away what the joke is, but it is probably the best moment on my favorite TV show of all time, Larry Sanders Show. Ritter was actually on that show twice. But there was one where it's Gene Siskel and he.
Right.
And they have a confrontation at one point that, please see the episode.
Yeah.
I cannot believe that they worked this joke in. And it really, there's a moment where you're like, did he really just say that? Is he
right?
Is John Ritter about to punch?
Does he know what he said
in the face?
Yeah,
yeah, like in real life. Like, yeah, I should. Yeah, so anyway.
Yeah, that's all points I agree with. Also,
nothing at 9:30 and then 10 o'clock Oscars Best Actors, whatever the hell that means.
It's a clip show of because the Oscars are coming up or something. But there's also a weird thing on called TV on Trial. This is a documentary special, and it says taped excerpts from the 1977 Miami murder trial of 15-year-old Ronnie Zamora, who stood accused of shooting to death an elderly neighbor. In this televised trial, which was really strange at the time, TV itself was the key issue. Zamora, his lawyer argued, had been so, quote, intoxicated by TV violence that he didn't know right from wrong at the time of the killing, hence the plea of not guilty by reason of insanity.
Wow.
1978.
Jeez.
That's fascinating. I don't know anything about that story. No. I feel like I need to look that up now.
Yeah.
That's probably the first instance I've ever heard of with someone blaming the sort of violence on television.
Yeah,
you know?
Or even music, maybe. When was all the Judas Priest stuff?
That was mid-80s. Okay. Kill Yourself, Do It. Yeah. Weird. Yeah. But I mean, this is the video game argument, you know, but this is 1978.
Right.
It's kind of fascinating. Wednesday, 8 o'clock. What'd you go with?
Wednesday, I've just got two programs Wednesday night because I'm going to be watching Bullet starting at 8, and that goes 2 hours. And you know, the car chase scene alone, obviously, Love me some Steve McQueen. I'm watching Bullet. And then at 9:30, though, if I start getting a little bit bored, I'm switching over to Monty Python for a little bit.
Yeah, you're always going to enjoy Monty Python.
Yeah, and you can watch a little bit of it and then go back to Bullet.
There's a couple of weird things on Wednesday night. On Nova that night, the episode is called The Insect Alternative.
Oh.
And this shows how farmers are dealing with pesticide-resistant pests. A California apple grower whose crops are infested with bugs called red scales, which sounds disgusting, seeds his orchards with wasps that feed off the scales. A little weird.
Yeah.
Then a thing called Snoopy's Musical on Ice.
Yeah, I almost chose that.
Snoopy, skated by Judy Sladke, a woman, is joined by Peanuts creator Charles M. Schulz himself.
Oh,
1968 Olympic champion Peggy Fleming performs from the Ice Follies and singer Becky Reardon and Larry Finlinson, taped in San Francisco.
Wow. Yeah, I almost chose that just from the title, but didn't read the description. Had I, maybe I would choose that.
It just, and there's a picture in the ad, and it just seems crazy.
Yeah, yeah, that seems
that screams 1978.
Oh, my goodness. Yeah, yeah, we just need some up with people.
Yeah, amazing. Thursday night, what'd you go with?
Thursday night, I'm doing another, actually, I'm switching all over the place. Oh, my goodness. So
it's Steve McQueen week, by the way, on TV 56.
Oh, that makes sense now. I was wondering, because of Great Escape, and I was wondering what the heck was going on. Okay, so at 8 o'clock, there's something called James Paul McCartney. What the hell does that mean?
Let me see what that is. James Paul McCartney. Paul McCartney's post-Beatles sound is the focus of this program with his wife Linda and his group Wings. Music, a medley including Maybe I'm Amazed, Uncle Albert, the theme song Live and Let Die, accompanied by clips from the James Bond movie and Yesterday. So it's a musical special on ABC.
Which I want to watch. I'm just wondering, where is James a typo? Why is it James Paul McCartney?
I think that's his actual name.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
Yeah.
And is this before the Sir? No, they were together. Yeah, so.
Yeah.
How interesting. And then... But I'm also flipping around to Welcome Back, Cotter during that 8 o'clock hour with Paul McCartney and Welcome Back, Cotter.
Hey.
I need me some Gabe Cap.
Welcome Back, Cotter is sort of the anti-Beatles.
the
Sweat Hogs. There's a really weird news magazine on PBS. Again, this is 1978. This is a look at diminishing sexual stereotypes in schools. Focuses on a girl soccer player and a boy ballet dancer. Also, a look at classes teaching boys to care for preschoolers and girls to work shop machines. That's still conversations people are having now.
Yeah.
You would think we would. I mean, we have come a little further from that, but
that's
crazy.
40 years ago?
More than 40 years ago.
Yeah.
That's nuts.
That is crazy.
That's everything on Thursday?
9:30, I'm doing Under the Influence with Peggy Cass and my main man himself, Kevin McCarthy.
Yep, of UHF and Invasion of the Body Snatchers fame.
I mean, yeah. So, but you got to read what the description is.
Peggy Cass and Kevin McCarthy test driving skills under simulated highway conditions, consuming measured amounts of liquor to show the deterioration of driving skills. It's basically Jackass with Kevin McCarthy.
I mean, that's what I want to watch. I'm having a lot of fun, especially after I'm watching a bunch of Welcome Back, Cotter and Paul McCartney for an hour.
Oh, yeah. You want to see Kevin McCarthy get hammered and try to drive.
Especially, who's Peggy Cass?
I don't know. I don't know who that is.
She might be really cool, too.
She might have died when they were filming that.
Oh, my God.
That's why she's not in there.
So then on Friday, I got nothing for 8 p.m.
Nothing.
Nothing.
Let me see what we have.
I'm gonna go and get a nightcap.
Wonder Woman's on.
You know, never could get into Wonder Woman. Did not care for the Linda Carter.
Linda Carter's one of the most beautiful women of all time.
Just not my style for some reason.
But also, I don't know if you read the plot of this episode. First of all, Frank Gorshin is in it.
Oh, well, okay. Maybe I'd watch for him.
The only Batman 66 villain who was truly terrifying.
Yeah, I know.
It's good way of putting it. Frank Gorshin plays a little old toy maker who creates android lookalikes to replace scientists working on a new super weapon.
Okay, never mind. I'm watching Wonder Woman at that time.
Yeah,
thank you for reminding me to look at the description. See, I'm so used to being a millennial, I just look at the headline. I'm not reading the article.
You can dig deeper. You got to look more than the first 15 pages.
Exactly.
There's also
what I was complaining about earlier.
They're also burning off a pilot. at this time.
You know, I saw the pilot, which would kind of be interesting because it's a pilot, but it's also like, it didn't sound that interesting.
They would always burn pilots off just to make back some of the money.
Sure.
And this one is Ephraim Zimbalist Jr. plays a divorced man who falls for a girl half his age and wild about Harry, a pilot for a yet unscheduled series. Bernie Capel is in it. Okay. And who plays Maggie? No one else. Stephanie Zimbalist. CPO Sharky moves back to this slot next week.
Well, there you go.
Yeah. So nothing at eight.
I would have watched the Wonder Woman. I would have said I'm not watching it. You would have said, hey, Matt, listen to the description.
Pretty cool.
And I would have said, put that shit on right now.
Androids and Frank Gorshin.
Yeah, Androids and Frank Gorshin does it for me.
And then
At 8:30, I'm going back to my Mary Tyler Moore.
Yep.
Well, always going to put that on. You can never not watch
Mary and Tyler. Rhoda fight 30-year-old spinsterhood with a party for both of their eligible male friends.
Man. Okay.
That just bummed me out.
Well, can't win them all.
Wow. 9 o'clock?
Incredible Hulk.
Yeah.
Which actually used to scare me as a kid. I would actually watch it just because of how much it would scare me. His eyes. I can see them in my head right now. It was all about his eyes.
Two things. You know? One, and I've told the story before, but I've watched The Incredible Hulk because it was the only comic book thing on, and I was a huge comic fan. My parents thought I loved the show, but I actually was terrified of it. My second birthday, they hired one of my uncle's bodybuilder friends to paint himself green and surprise me as the Hulk. And I lost my shit and hid under the bed. And they still didn't. They're like, well, what's the problem?
Yeah.
And secondly, are you familiar with the Hulk out list?
The what?
The Hulk out list.
No.
So Ken Johnson, who created the Hulk, on his website, he has it. Someone compiled the list of every cause of David Banner to Hulk out in every episode.
Wow.
And they're all real, and it's one of the funniest things I've ever read because it's literally like, hit by a boulder, hit with a wrench, doesn't have change for a payphone, someone yells at him, trash thrown at him. Like, it's so great. It's well worth looking at.
I don't know if you know the guy who does it, and I don't really engage with social media, but a friend of mine introduced me a few years ago. I haven't kept up with it, but there's that guy who does, like, really... like intellectual film reviews, but from the voice of the Incredible Hulk.
Yes, yeah.
And so it's like both like Hulk think this, but it's always like
on Twitter.
It's
a Twitter thing.
So he uses all these big.
Yeah.
And I thought that was a pretty clever idea.
But the thing that always bothered me was, and this was the problem with comic books of forever, you have the Incredible Hulk, and the villain's always like construction workers. It's not, there's no super villains, you know, it's just evil developers. Like it just doesn't work.
Although it's funny because then you see, you watch Pumping Iron and you realize what a pussycat Lou Ferrigno was.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, Schwarzenegger's basically just knocking him through the entire film.
Well, Schwarzenegger was like just a hormone at that point.
Right.
But yeah, also on that night is one of my favorite Jaws ripoffs. It's called Mako, The Jaws of Death.
Oh, my.
Killer Sharks on a Rampage of Terror from the Deep stars Richard Jekyll, Jennifer Bishop, Harold Sakata, John Chandler, and B.D.
B.D.?
Yep.
The B.D.
The letter B and then D. Do they give it a... What do they give it for... They don't even give it a star thing. What? Sharks supply the excitement in Mako, The Jaws of Death, about a diver who retaliates against those who hunt and kill the predators.
Yeah, well, I think I'd rather watch Sharknado.
Yeah, I agree. Anything else? That's the whole week.
9:30, I'm doing Sing a Sign, I think it's called.
Sing a Sign.
Yeah, at 9 o'clock also, there's at 9 o'clock and 9:30, there's some specials about persons with deafness.
Oh, yeah.
And they're doing a musical
Silent movie. Minority, which is myths about deafness are dispelled in this documentary, exploring the lives of people with hearing impairments, including a profile of the Coronado family, the parents and two of three children have hearing problems. And then at 9:30, it's deaf performers are featured in this musical review. Are you familiar with Deafula?
No, but I've seen concerts performed by people who are deaf, and it's really fascinating and beautiful to watch. It's almost like there's a choreography to it.
I saw The Revolution, Prince's Revolution, last year, which was an amazing show. And the woman sitting next to me in the audience was deaf. And the way they performed Purple Rain was pretty magical. And Wendy and Lisa was like, look, we know he's not here. we can't sing this. Right. We're just going to play it and the audience has to sing it. And so the whole audience sang it, but the woman was just signing it.
Oh, cool.
And, but was like so into it. And it was just kind of a really cool, but Defula, despite the exploitive title, is a totally signed, completely hearing impaired version of Dracula from 1979 or 80. And it's really good. And it's really well made. It's up on YouTube, I think. It kind of disappeared. But it's really cool. It's worth watching. It's an interesting take on
it. No, I love stuff like that. Anyone who knows me knows I've spent like now like geez, like half my life working with the Kids of Widney High. Over the last few years, it's been a lot less. They don't really play or do anything anymore, but I'm still close with a lot of the kids. And Michael Monaghan, the head of the band, we're actually doing a children's book that's going to come out a year from the summer. And we're hoping it turns into a series. And a lot of it's to teach kids about other people with disabilities and whatnot. But through working with them and going to other groups that they worked with or partnered with, I got really involved and got to see all this amazing stuff like that. And, you know, people that were deaf that were musicians and people that were blind that were photographers and making films and all different kinds of outsider art because the kids that would be high themselves were just partnered up or worked with so many different groups, particularly at the time in L.A. It actually was just a wild coincidence. That same friend of mine, Andrew, who introduced me to Fugazi and Pavement, introduced me to the Kids of Widney High. And like that week, some other gal played me a Kids of Widney High record. And I was like, oh, my friend Andrew just played me some of this stuff. And I got really into it, looked them up, and it turns out Widney High School is down the street from USC.
Yeah.
And I just went over there one day, sat in on one of their classes, became friends with Michael, drove him somewhere, happened to be playing Donovan on my CD player, and goes, I really like you a lot. You seem like a good guy. And then we just became friendly. I became friends with the kids of Whitney High themselves. We made all these short films and a documentary. Yeah. And so that was just a big, big part of my life and really got me into outsider art. I'd been into that kind of stuff since I was younger anyway. For some reason, I was really weirdly obsessed with Mice and Men.
Yeah.
And different movies and TV shows that dealt with disability. Whenever I have a chance for something like that. So to see to bring it all back, to see in 1978 a music review with people with deafness, that would have been pretty fascinating.
It is kind of shocking and humbling to see in a lot of ways how much more progressive 1978 was than 2019 sometimes. Sure. And that does happen sometimes when I look through these old TV guides. I get kind of bummed out on where I'm like, have we gone backwards somehow in some ways? Things are better in a lot of ways, but then, you know, like just primetime TV, some of the representation that they got, we don't get on a national scale like that. It's hard to get anything on a national scale like that. But, you know, it's when people look back at things like to your point about Three's Company, where you're like, wow, a lot of the stuff you couldn't get away with now, you know, and that kind of thing. At the same time, they were presenting stuff that we would not present now to a mainstream audience as a totally normal representation for people. And it's weird how we're not constantly moving forward sometimes. Some things are regressed or you know, go just don't happen now.
If anyone's really interested in this kind of stuff, Ken and I were talking about this earlier, but I'm really into this this relatively new book that just came out about the making of In Living Color. And again, just really, really, really fascinating to read about what was going on behind the scenes. And just even things like Keenan Ivory Wayans himself being very angry that the original pilot, you probably know this, Ken, but I mean, they shot it. And I mean, they didn't even air it until almost a year later because Fox was just freaking out. Despite the fact that everyone loved it, everyone was laughing at it, it was getting passed around all over Hollywood, it was being sold on those tables in New York, and one of the reasons why was Fox was just nervous, what are people going to say about this? And Keenan, in the book, in an interview that the author did, David Peisner, you know, Keenan was basically saying, you know, they were saying things like they wanted, you know, these different African-American groups to watch it, and they wanted these different kind of consultants to come in from the African-American community and NAACP, this, that, and the other. And on one level, it's like, okay, I guess, you know, your heart's in the right place in some ways with that. But Keenan Ivory Wayans is making the point, like, why are we doing this just for this show that happens to be mostly African-American? Yeah. You know, like, would you,
you know, if you're going to have, you know, the next Woody Allen movie, you're going to have, you know, some, you know, the ADL or something go over the script.
It's that cliche, like as a comedian, it's that cliche with like, oh, the black guys laughing, you guys can all laugh.
Right.
You know?
And it really upset Keenan Ivory Wayans. And it wasn't that Fox thought that it was like offensive or, you know, are white people going to get angry or whatever. It was more of like, we just want to make sure that other black people are going to be okay with this. And Keenan Ivory Wayans is like, this is for everybody.
Yeah.
Who cares? Like, why are you doing this just with me?
On so, SNL, you're not like, are white people okay with the sketch?
Yeah. So it was really, and there's a lot of that in the book and some things that actually really surprised me. It even went earlier back to Keenan Ivory Wayans was actually in a black improv troupe. It might have been the first of all time with Reginald Vell Johnson.
Yeah.
From Family Matters and all these great movies and whatnot. And they were dealing with that too. And Reginald Vell Johnson in the interview was like, you know, we were glad and proud to be in an all black group, but, you know, it wasn't just about that. Like, we were funny too, by the way. You know, like, we didn't want to just be this novelty thing.
Yeah.
And Vell Johnson really makes that clear. And so it's interesting. And again, even that must have been probably 78 or 79 when he was feeling and thinking that way. So there's a lot of that with the In Living Color book. And just, of course, people like, you know, Kelly Caulfield and Jim Carrey talking about what it was like to be the quote-unquote token white people on the show and what that was actually like and how they didn't really think about it in that way during those days and whatnot. So, but I'm really enjoying the In Living Color book. It's called Homie, Don't Play That, of course. The interviews are just so forthright. I'm almost surprised how warts and all it is.
Well, I think we're far enough away from that show, and that show for as... infamous isn't quite the right word, but legendary is not the right word either. If somewhere in the middle, if there's a word that's
this is
groundbreaking,
barrier breaking,
didn't really re-air. The current generation really doesn't know anything about it other than they've heard of the people on it, maybe.
Right.
So I think we're far enough removed, and it's not as much in people's minds that they can be very candid about it. Mm-hmm. Plus, most of those people went on to be much more successful, so I think they can talk freely about that thing without any...
Yeah, you know, that's a good point. It's not like they're worried they're going to lose their jobs or anything like that. But yeah, the really fascinating thing, too, is how many times can I use the word fascinating? I had no idea how many writers came from that show.
Oh, yeah.
Of course, having done the Nickelodeon book, I knew that Buddy Sheffield, who would go on to create Roundhouse, or co-create Roundhouse... was a writer on there, so I knew that from before, and I think he brought on some of the writers from In Living Color to Roundhouse, which is why Roundhouse has kind of a In Living Color sort of sensibility to it. That's definitely a show that everyone who was involved, you know, different directors,
yeah,
and writers and producers would go on to do really, really big things, not just the actors.
Well, I mean, to wrap up it's sort of, you know, I think in the case of Fox, they were probably trying to cover their ass financially, but it becomes this thing, which this may be, and I'm totally just talking this out now without really thinking about it, but where one of the reasons we're not as advanced in some ways is people in an attempt to be so accommodating and progressive actually become very patronizing and very minimizing. And that's sort of where we're at now, as opposed to what it looks like we were at in 1978. And that sort of feeds into the way that they handled In Living Color.
Well, because maybe they were dealing with it in a much more direct way, because so much was still actually going on from the 50s and 60s.
Yeah.
Whereas now, obviously, a lot of that's still happening, unfortunately. But there's a little bit of distanciation between some of the people talking about and trying to deal with it. And the people were actually like, no, I remember when we weren't allowed at this place or that place. And to your point, the best example is when I was working with the Kids of Widney High more directly, our worst enemies were people that were trying to protect them.
Yeah.
And people that were patronizing them. I mean, I took them on a tour up the West Coast. We made a documentary about that. There were multiple times that, and all of the kids at Whitney High were older than I. And, you know, there's some of them even had a problem with that name, but then we'd say, well, the Beastie Boys never changed their name. The Beach Boys never changed their name. Dixie Chicks or Indigo Girls. Like, you know, it is what it is. But there were multiple times where, you know, one of the and again, they weren't trying to be mean or anything. They just didn't know any better. One of the venue people that we would go to at a concert or something would come up and talk to me. Oh, does so-and-so need this or does so-and-so need that? Yeah. And say,
they're right there.
Ask him. Well, I'm not his monitor.
They robbed them of their humanity a bit. Like, I remember a friend of mine...
and again, they weren't trying to be mean or anything. They just didn't know anyone. And I had to be like, they're right there. Yeah. Go ask them.
You know,
like,
a friend of mine, you know, used to work in special education, and I remember what he... There was a kid who might have Down syndrome or something like that. But the kid was being an asshole.
Yeah.
And he said, my friend was like, this kid's an asshole.
Yeah.
And someone was like, how can you say that? And he's like, no, he's not. Like, don't rob him of his humanity.
Exactly.
It's because he could still be a complete asshole. Like, there's nothing, like, that's what people are. That's, they can be people,
they
you
can
know?
Be jerks like that, yeah. too. No, there was
that's a guy humanity, you know?
There was this old man. We were waiting in line at a grocery store, and everyone was waiting for a really long time. This old man just rode up in his wheelchair, looked all grumbling, cantankerous, and just started ordering. And I said, excuse me. And someone was like, hey, come on. And I was like, no, we were all waiting here. Like, you know, and the worst thing was, it's one of the reasons why a lot of the Kids of Widney High members love South Park so much. Especially, there is a specific episode that they did that where, you know, the certain group didn't want Timmy to play with the Lords of the Underground.
Right.
That happened to the Kids of Widney High in real life multiple times. And in fact, one of their greatest supporters, really great guy, Mike Patton of Mr. Bungle and Faith No More, put out their second album on his label, brought them on tour of Mr. Bungle, really put his money where his mouth is, still a big supporter and fan. But we got to interview him for a shorter documentary I did for film when I was still in film school. And he said, when he first said he wanted the kids to open for him on the Mr. Bungle tour, that Warner Brothers freaked out. Warner Brothers was basically like, no way. And it was, again, it wasn't because, you know, we don't want to see people with disabilities on the stage. People make fun of them. People will be mean, blah, blah, blah. And he goes, you know what? Come to a Kids of Widney High show. I will bring you. And you'll see. And he said he remembered turning to, it was actually a woman, the lady from Warner Brothers. And he said he saw her start to smile and nod her head. And then she got it. And but that happened multiple times where it was people were like, oh, people make fun of them.
You're exploiting them.
Mean. And you know what they would say about that? They would say, well, for the getting made fun of her mean thing, they would say, you know, look, we want people to come to our show and have a good time. And if they're laughing at us or whatever it is, as long as they're having a good time, we don't really mind. You know, and there are musicians and actors and things who part of their gag is that people are kind of poking some fun or whatever it is. And the Kids of Widney High were very aware of it. And my good friend Arthur Bradford of How's Your News, a similar group that was on MTV for a little while and did some things. When the exploitation question came up, he would get really upset and be like, that is assuming they don't know what they're doing.
Yeah,
these are people who want to be on stage. These are people who want to perform. Yeah. This is not, we're pushing them. This is not, we're getting, you know, and trust me, no one was making any money on the Kids of Widney High. We were spending money to like drive them to shows and all this stuff. I mean, that was challenging to get them there.
This isn't a hidden camera prank show.
No, no. So, and we were always very aware that I got very involved in the band. Again, it's 20 years later and I'm still working with them and doing stuff with them and whatnot. And you know, it has happened over the years that we've tried to do Kids of Widney High movies, Kids of Widney High TV shows. I know that Arthur was having similar problems with How's Your News, even with Trey and Matt from South Park involved, and they were really great and very involved. It was, people were scared, and it was a taboo that they didn't want to touch. And you know what ends up happening is now we don't have a TV show or a movie about that particular group of people.
Right.
Every now and then little things pop in.
We had Speechless
and whatnot,
which got canceled.
Right.
But was an amazing show.
Yeah.
And it gave people this humanity and it was sweet and dark and funny and gallows humor. And I loved that show for that very reason.
Right. And but so there's an example of, again, it's not that people, oh, we don't want to see people with disabilities. It's, oh, we don't want to deal with the taboo. We don't want to, you know.
It's about them as an audience, not about the performers.
Right. And then you're not letting them, then we don't get to have that TV show. We don't get to have that movie.
Yeah.
And trust me, I'll just say, I know I've been going on and on about this, but just something I'm passionate about. The Kids of Winnie High are an amazing group of people. And each one of them is individually talented, too. Elisa writes, she wrote like an 800-page autobiography that's really interesting. Daniel put himself through community college even though he lives with blindness and cerebral palsy. It took him 5 years to get his broadcasting degree. He's doing podcast stuff and radio stuff. You know, each one of them, we wanted to bring one of them, is nicknamed Pee-wee, Louise. We wanted to literally start doing stand-up comedy with him and take him around to stand-up comedy places and whatnot.
Oh, I wouldn't recommend doing that to anyone.
But no, I mean, it just... In addition to the music they were making, they were all individually very talented at different things. And here it is all these years later and, you know, they don't have a platform. They're not out there. And it's because – and I've been there for some of these meetings. I mean, we were meeting with HBO, Comedy Central, MTV, and it was like, this is great, guys, but I don't know. Well, it's again, like, it's,
you know, what we said earlier, like some of the best art is created when there are constrictions and when there are things people have to work around and they come up with more innovative, exciting things. And that goes down to disabilities as well, you know, because they have to look at things differently or approach stuff differently. So they're gonna, you're going to get something interesting. So, but this has been great. Thank you so much for talking to me.
And thanks for letting me kind of go off on a tangent here.
No.
Kids of Widney High.
All about the tangents. Yeah. Cool. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you.
There you go. That's Matt. Go to MatthewKlickstein.com and you can see everything he's working on, his novel, his comic series, his past books. I am in awe of how much stuff he pumps out on an annual basis per annum. I think that's the term. It's not a clinical term, but let's make it one. Anyway, let's make more clinical terms, you and I, next week on a brand new edition, because we have a new one each and every week. And if you subscribe to the show, you can hear that each and every week without even having to think about it. So please do so. And if you have a moment and you want to rate and review the show and you are subscribing, that would be excellent as well. You can, as I said in the beginning, email me or go to our Patreon or any or all of those things or none of those things. Anyway, we'll see you again next time for a brand new edition of TV Guidance Counselor.
Just one of my favorite spokespeople for oranges of all time.